I think we're live. It's always a surprise. I'm sorry that I am flustered every single time, but yeah, we're live. So hi, everybody. We're back with the amazing Tori Cordiano. Tori is a licensed clinical psychologist specializing in the emotional, psychological, and behavioral development of children and adolescents. Tori, thank you so much for doing this again. So my favorite part of talking to you is that not only do you give really stellar advice, but you have the most soothing voice when you deliver it.
This may beg to differ, but thank you.
Well, for us, you over-deliver for us. So we keep getting questions in our Facebook Messenger about, you know, raising adolescents and the struggles we're going through. And so we thought, let's just hop on here now and get you to answer them, bang, bang, bang. Sure. So the first one is, how can I help my teen support a friend whose parent is in rehab? Are there any suggestions for what a teen should and should not say? And I'm also at a loss for how to help my child through that process.
Yeah. Oh, gosh, that's such a tough situation. You know, I think the guidance that you can give your teenager is that in supporting her or his friend, the main job that he can do is just to be there, to be able to listen, to be able to, when the friend wants to talk about it, great. When the friend needs a break from thinking about it or talking about it, you can be a person who can offer a, let's go for a walk, or let's FaceTime, or let's, you know, jump on a game together and play, that you can be both of those parts. The thing that you'll want to watch out for your teenager, because teenagers have the biggest hearts and are really, really invested in their friends and their friendships and want to help their friends feel their best. So they often err on the side of putting too much into trying to help their friends solve their conflicts, or to step too much into their friends' emotional messes. So the guidance around that will be helping your teen create boundaries that allow him to be there for his friend, but also keep him from getting too far into a situation where he doesn't have the tools or the expertise or the power or any of those things to really solve the problem. So the goal can be around supporting his friend, being there for his friend, being a place where his friend can talk about it when he wants to, can choose not to talk about it when he doesn't want to. And that's really goes a long way. Often, you know, teenagers may worry about this part a little bit less than adults. Adults are really often very concerned about saying the right thing or the wrong thing, or saying it the right way or the wrong way. Teenagers have that for sure, but I think at times they consider that slightly less. They can be a little bit more off the cuff. They can be a little bit more spontaneous with their friends, which is a really good thing, because there's not a whole lot that you can say that is that you're really going to step in it in an irreparable way. I think, you know, if you are there and you are checking in and saying, how are you doing? Do you want to talk about your dad? Do you want to not talk about your dad today? You know, to just sort of frame it like that, there's not too many things that I think most teenagers would say that would be so horrifically hard for the other person to handle. So there's not one way to get it right. And the risk of being there in the wrong way, I think, is lower than just not being there at all.
So that is such great advice. And considering how teens tend to overinvest, that's great. But if I'm the parent and I see my kid crossing that line, I'm not sure how I frame it and how I kind of rein it back in.
Yeah. So I think if you're lucky enough that your teenager is sharing some of this with you, or saying like, you know, I'm really worried about so-and-so's dad. And if he's in rehab, actually in rehab right now, then some of the safety stuff, you know, and those sorts of things may be actually taken care of. But if it's worrying about a parent with a substance abuse problem who is not currently receiving the care that they need, or, you know, where the risk is higher that there's a safety concern, I think you can think with your teenager about, gosh, this is really big stuff that your friend is dealing with. This is above his pay grade. This is above what we would want any 15-year-old to have to manage. And your friend is not going to be able to fix this. That's a hard situation to be in. And you might, if it seems like it needs to go further, you might say, so what do you think is your friend's plan if he's really worried that his dad is in a dangerous situation? Because if there's concrete ways to connect with another adult, you know, if it's the other parent, or having ways to make sure that that friend has a safe place to go if it's not safe to be at home, that there are concrete ways that your teenager can, you know, kind of pass along, or that those ways are talked about so that it's not on the teenagers to try to fix the situation. The goal would be to know when and how to connect with other grownups who can help keep this teenager safe and to help your own child maintain the boundaries that allow him to be there, but not to be investing so much of himself that it is making it less than safe for him, either psychologically, physically, any of those ways.
You know, I've heard you say things like this over and over again. I forget every time how powerful it is when you say, talk to your kid. I mean, I know it's so obvious to you, but like, I'm looking for like, you know, well, draw the line in the sand here and you go right to talk, to start problem solving with your kid. So,
well, you know, we may go in as parents, we may go in with, okay, here's what they need to know. Here's my plan. Here's how I think it should work. And, you know, I've got to convince them that they can't be in this with their friend or trying to solve it. And 2 minutes into the conversation, you may realize like your teen gets that. Your son gets that. He knows he shouldn't be in this situation. He knows he can't solve it, but he doesn't know what to do. And he wants to be there for his friend. So instead of thinking about it coming into the situation, like, here's what we need to establish and here's how I'm going to lay it down, you can come into it thinking like, we're going to both look at this problem on the same side and see where we overlap and see where we need to make some tweaks to keep everybody safe.
Okay, next question. So this is a really sad one. There's so much discussion about death right now all around us because of COVID and just the constant news cycle. And this middle school kid is waking up in the middle of the night crying. He's so afraid of dying and his mother just doesn't know what to do.
Okay. So first I'll say middle school is not too old to be doing the same things we would think about with 7-year-olds, which is how much is the news on? How much are you talking about it? How much are you scrolling about it? How much are you texting with your friend or talking with your friend in the yard while your, you know, middle schooler is overhearing? So there needs to be healthy limits on how much time we're spending engaging with this. And I think with this now, this wave of uncertainty about what school is going to look like, it's so hard not to be talking about this with other adults, with other parents. It's hard for middle schoolers not to be talking about it because it's right in front of them as we're thinking about sports being canceled and school starting remotely and all of these things. But you can model and enforce boundaries around how much we're going to have the news on, how much we're going to be talking about this. And it's not that we want to keep middle schoolers ill-informed. They need to have a sense of what's going on, but they don't need to be drowning in it. There's no good that comes from immersing themselves in it when there's nothing that they can do about it. And then we think about what do we put into that time instead? We put all of the things that help them feel their best. So let's put the phone down and go for a bike ride. You know, if you're physically distancing with friends and you have a friend you can invite on a hike, like, let's do that. Who should we, you know, text to meet up? Let's get dinner and, you know, take it, you know, have a dinner picnic outside in our yard. Whatever it is that your middle schooler is going to be willing or open to doing that is totally separate from all of these big concerns that we're thinking about. If it gets them moving even better, if it gets them outside even better. And then you can say, you know, at other times, and this can be at bedtime, this can be when you're in the car together over breakfast, it seems like you're really struggling with this. This is hard stuff. Do you want to talk about it? You know, to put it out there as like, we can talk about this. If they're going to engage with it, better that they engage with it with you and actually talk about it than scroll and scroll and scroll online and see these worst case scenarios. As adults, we see these worst case scenario headlines and it's hard to sleep and we catastrophize. Now put that on a 13-year-old with a not fully developed prefrontal cortex and see where that gets them. They don't have the perspective. They don't have the reasoning skills. They can't deduce what is fact and what is exaggerated fiction. And it's not a fair position to put them in.
I would say a lot of adults are in the exact same spot.
Yep.
Struggle. Okay, this one. My son is 16, very secretive about his girlfriend. He said he's not going to tell me anything. How do I get him to open up?
Okay, so being 16 and not wanting to tell your parent anything about your girlfriend is actually so developmentally healthy and normal. And I think that if you ask most 16-year-olds, how much are you going to share about your relationship with your mom or dad? They're going to say very little. It's not any of their business, right? 16-year-olds are on the cusp of young adulthood, and in their minds, they're there. And this relationship is not, you know, none of their parents' business. I think you can... You don't have to make a whole lot about the statement that, you know, I'm closing the door on this. You don't have the right to know this. I think what matters more are the actions and what this looks like as it unfolds. You know, if the relationship seems healthy, if it's not taking over 100% of your son's life, if, you know, healthy boundaries are in place, if you don't have big concerns, he really doesn't have to share a lot about it with you. It's a private relationship, and this is a hard part as teenagers get older. But unless there's big, you know, concerns that you have, there's not a whole lot that he may feel like he needs to share, wants to share, or necessarily has to share. That doesn't mean that you can't be interested in the relationship. And if this is a relationship that is actually more than just, you know, we're kind of hanging out, maybe he would say that they're actually, you know, together, then you would say like, oh, you know, it seems like, you know, you've been spending more time with her. We'd love to have her over. We'd love to, you know, whatever. Like, and he may or may not be open to that, but you can continue to extend that. And you want it to come from a really positive, you know, just sort of, I want to know this person who's important to you. You're important to me. And if she's important to you, then I want to know her too. And coming from a friendly way rather than a, I need to know the details on what you're doing with this girl and when, and, you know, everything about it. The first way of doing that will be better received than the second way. You may still get shut down, but at least if you're coming from the spirit of you're important to me, she's important to you, therefore I'd like to know her, there's a better chance of getting a little bit more intel.
I think a little bit of the hard part here is that there's this whole side of parenting advice that the better you can be at having this open relationship where your kid trusts you and comes to you. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, your friends are talking about how their kids tell them everything. Mm-hmm. And now you've just failed at something. Mm-hmm. And in fact, maybe you're not supposed to be part of their dating.
Yeah. 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 And this is where the comparison piece is not that helpful. And you can think about, well, what are the nice parts of our relationship? What are the, you know, maybe he's not sharing a lot about this, but maybe he will, you know, go on a hike with me, or maybe he's so fantastic with his younger brother, or maybe he never complains about family dinners. And when you're feeling that sting from your friend who's saying, oh, he doesn't tell you anything, like I am friends with my son's girlfriend, that you can then go back to that. Okay, good for them, not for us. This is how it's unfolding for us. And if we don't have big concerns about it, that's okay.
That's great. This is a tough one. In today's racial climate, my teen is having a tough time because her dad is a police officer. Any advice?
Yeah, this is a tough one. I think you start with empathy, right? So I think you start with sitting with your teenager of, gosh, what's it like right now to have, you know, your mom or your dad is a police officer and all of this is unfolding? Where are you with this? What thoughts are you having? What questions do you have? And if hopefully they might be willing to talk about it, but I think really starting from a place of just kind of sussing out how they're feeling about it. If they're having a hard time with it, if they're, you know, saying things like, it's so hard because I worry about my mom, but I also see, you know, the racial justice piece of this, and I want to go protest, or I want to, you know, be part of this, or I feel like I'm part of the problem because of what my parent does. Part of it is just holding space for them to kind of just put all of this out there. I think this is something that many people who have family members in law enforcement are feeling right now, whether it's the person themselves or a partner of or a child of, that this is something that many, many, many good people are grappling with, of how do we support the person in our family that we care so deeply about, that we are proud of for doing the good work that they do, while also standing up for the racial justice side of this and advocating for the Black Lives Matter movement and advocating for justice for all people. So you might think with your teenager about what steps would feel good for you to take, you know, assuming that maybe there's a juxtaposition of wanting to support the parent and then also wanting to be a part of this racial justice movement, what steps would be good to take? Because it's not a mutually exclusive thing. It's not either you support your parent who's in law enforcement or you support the Black Lives Matter movement, that there's plenty of space. And especially I think for families who are in this, who have a family member in law enforcement, there's plenty of space to do both of those things. It just involves being creative. And you might actually talk with your teenager about, you're in a unique position. You can really understand the side of having a parent in law enforcement. And that's not something that many of your friends may be able to understand. If they don't have a mom who's a cop or a dad who's a police officer, that they can't understand that. You have that understanding. You don't have the other part of the understanding from being uniquely in that position, but you can bring this perspective. And the way that we do that is through a lot of listening. And then when we're ready, sharing some of what our own experience is.
Okay, last question. You know, we talk a lot about being on our kids' side. And this mom put out there, my son is 13 and going through a huge growth spurt. He's unhappy with us and hates his school, mouths off at us every day. He's so rude. I don't know how I can be on his side.
Oh, and I'm wondering, okay, so a lot of this is 13, check, 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 right? Developmentally, right where we expect you to be. And then you add this layer of what this summer has, the spring and summer and projecting into the fall has felt like for teenagers. And it's just another layer of ick. You know, if we think about parents right now, you could say like, my mom is 43 and she's really crabby and she's, you know, not as pleasant as she normally is because we're all worrying about these really big things. I said this with the last question, but I think we start with as much empathy as we can possibly muster, which means that when your teenager has just slammed the door or said something incredibly rude or embarrassed you in front of in public by, you know, just mouthing off or doing something like that, that before you actually respond, you force yourself to get in the habit of pause, breathe, think for a moment what it's like to be 13 right now. Think for a moment. I mean, I think most of us have pretty vivid memories of 13. And for many of us, it was not the most pleasant time in our lives. And then add on to that the huge amount of stress that we're all feeling this spring and summer, and mix that up with the developmental cocktail of being 13. And if you can get in the habit of before responding, pause, breathe, consider what that is like for your teenager, you're going to be leading from a more accepting, open place, which paves the way for a much better chance at actual conversation, actual problem solving, actual, you know, getting on the same page with this. If we can start with empathy, we get so, so, so much further. It doesn't mean that we're letting teenagers off the hook. It's not okay to scream insults. It's not okay to be aggressive. You know, you can think about in your house, what are the house rules that we are all expected to maintain? We're not going to let teenagers off the hook for that. But we are going to try to be as empathetic as possible and to say, like, you know, this, I can't imagine how hard this summer has been. I know it's been hard for me as a parent. 13 is about your friends and you haven't been able to see them. What's that been like? You know, not on the heels of an argument, but at other times that you let your teenager know, I'm not just here for the conflict. I want to know how you're doing. And I want you to be able to share that with me.
As always, it's amazing to get your input. Thank you so much, Dr. Tori Cordiano, for taking the time to talk to us.
Thank you for having me. It's a great way to start the day.